He
Record.
does.
Okay, here we go. Starting music. Okay, go.
Oh, and welcome to another edition to Sister Talk. I'm your host, Gail Talaferro, and I am here with two awesome women, two co-hosts who I love dearly, right here. No, right here, right here. We have Marzina Sample. She's our image consultant, life coach. Hey, and we're going Western today, y'all. Hi,
yeah.
Say hi, Marzina.
Yeah, hello, the boss is smiling.
Hey.
And I'm then, switching up every now and then, you know.
There's nothing the matter with that. And then we have the baby of the bunch. We have Marlon Wilson, our in-house comedian, you know, our life learner. I had to put that in there. You know, and you know, she's the baby of the bunch. Say hi, Marmar.
Hi, but I'm learning. You ladies guide me. I love y'all. Thank you.
We okay, love so you, Mar.
Today is February 28th and 2021. I'm like, time is going by fast. It's just going, you know, it's the month is just flying by. And I guess it's because I've been so busy. But I did want to talk about reinventing ourselves and how the time is now to get it going. But before we jump into that, we're going to have Marzina motivate and inspire us.
All right. So I was doing some research last week for something else. And my focus this week is anger. Okay. Now, we all know, you know, I used to have anger issues, road rage, you know, but that that has calmed down so much. Like the outburst, you know, is maybe like at 50% now. So that's a good thing. And I don't ride up on people or give fingers anymore. I don't do any of that. You know, I just say keywords and, you know, mad for a minute and then move on. So I learned some interesting information about anger. Okay. When you have an angry outburst, do you know that you are two times more likely to have a heart attack? So 2 hours after you flip out, you're doubling your chances of having a heart attack. What?
Is that because you're not calming yourself back down? You're still thinking of the emotion and it's just heightening the stress level or something, maybe?
The stress is there.
Yeah, but once you get at such a high level, it takes a certain amount of time to come down. Even, for instance, okay, if I had an argument with you, okay, I might be thinking about it all day, reliving it, blah, blah, blah. That's different. And that's taking it, whoa, tripling your chances then.
Yeah.
But just when you take your levels so high, it automatically takes a couple hours for them to come back down to a normal place. So I found that kind of shocking. Like, what? Now, when you have repressed anger, meaning reliving something, you know, mad, or we can talk about people that are prejudiced, repressed anger, they are tripling their chances of having a heart attack. Yeah. If you lash out in anger, you are tripling your chances of having a stroke. What? That's up to the first 2 hours of the outburst. That can be from a blood clot or bleeding on the brain. So we're doubling our chances of a heart attack, tripling our chances of having a stroke. Also, when we have anger outbursts, it weakens our immune system. I'm like, what? I mean, I know stress, you know, weakens the immune system, but anger, I wasn't aware of that. So just by having an angry outburst or thinking of something that angers you from the past, you weaken your immune system for 6 hours after. Mm. As you know, we need our immune system to fight off germs, to fight off the different sicknesses, common colds, serious stuff. It's important. So that kind of took me as a surprise. Yeah, it took me by surprise as well. Now, having hostility in your heart can cause inflammation in your airways. So that can affect your breathing, your lungs. I'm like, why didn't I learn this stuff a long time ago? I never knew being angry for just a short amount of time can cause this much damage. So of course, having anger in any way, shape, or form will shorten your lifespan.
Well, Z, I'm not going to look at my bank account because it makes me angry every time I don't have the money to buy something I want.
You know, I deal with that too, Marlon. Yeah, but you might get a little upset, but I don't think, I mean, if you keep trying to shop, you carry that anger, but yeah, I get that. Any kind of anger. So in today's world, we all know people are looking for reactions. People are doing things to set you off. They want to see your reaction, okay? Just looking at the news, looking at the prejudice things, looking at the attacks on minorities, all these things, it takes me there. Even if it's just for 20 minutes, it takes me there. And I did not realize what an effect this is having on my health. It just, it floored me. Just a small amount of anger can do this much damage. So you know what? I've calmed down so much from the younger years and I'm ready to calm down way more than I used to. So some tips of what you can do to kind of soothe yourself. I say before you even leave out of the house in the morning, pray. I know we pray. Because look, everyone should be praying before they walk outside that door because Lord knows we don't know what we're going to confront in our day, in this day and time. So pray. Even if it's a short prayer, pray. Meditate. Just take, I don't care if it's 5 to 20 minutes a day, take time, soothe yourself, talk encouraging words to yourself, have your favorite drink, play soothing music, whatever it is that you like to do, even if you don't have a lot of time, it is so important to take at least 5 to 20 to 30 minutes a day to do just that. I try to read for an hour a day. Why? That soothes me. It takes me places outside of what I'm dealing with right here. So it's kind of like an imaginary thing and a good and juicy novel. So that does it for me, okay? Stay positive. You know, having a positive attitude does change your situation and it helps change people around you. We've got to keep the positive in so much negativity that we see each day. So just try to be positive. Something ticks you off. Like, nope, Satan, we're not doing that today. I'm not falling into those traps. The last thing, help others. Mm-hmm. When you help others, that boosts your mood. It boosts others' mood. It takes your mind off of things and it's showing gratitude in a certain way. So help others. Occupy yourself doing good things. And guess what? Your mind will be in such a better place. So I want you guys to practice. Marlon, I don't know if you exactly have road rage, but.
Oh, yes, I do.
I know you know, dip around, those kind of things. So.
Well, you know,
I knew this would apply.
I'm glad you, you know, gotten somewhat over your road rage. I've ridden with her, you know, a few times. Yeah, that was a scary thing when we're not moving.
You said when you're not moving. Now that's terrible.
But I can add to that, Marzina. I can add to that list. One of the things that I realized, because people, we have to learn how to get out of our emotions, okay? And that's the one thing that gets us in trouble is when we're in our emotions. So what I really look at is when someone's upset, I'm not going to feed into their emotions. I'm just going to remind myself that it's not my issue.
Right.
That's their issue, not my issue. So I'm not going to let my emotions get involved. And it took a while to learn how to control the tongue. See, that's one thing that I prayed to God about, is to help me to control the tongue. It wasn't an instant thing. I had to work on that for years. And now I've gotten a whole lot better. I can see where I'm going when I control my tongue. So when I see someone upset, somebody driving, you know, and, you know, they trying to crush me, I'm like, you know, go in front of me. I seen somebody go around me, and then they didn't know a cop was behind them, and a cop went around me and gave them a ticket. So that taught me right there, don't feed into what they're doing, because I could have been the one getting the ticket if I was to respond it, like speeding up on them and having some kind of, no, we not going to do that. So, yeah, so I get that to stay calm, because I even slow up now. I'm such a slow driver. I drive so differently.
Slow, Gail.
Huh?
I wouldn't say slow.
Now, one time I had to get us someplace in a hurry. The shit would have left us if I didn't. But anyway.
That's true. But no, you like to put the foot to the pedal. Okay. Not as bad as Marlon, but.
Yeah, you know, I take my time now.
I place the beat. I allot myself time frames and how to get places. I know they say that 5 minutes early means that you're on time. That doesn't mean the same for me. Leaving out 5 minutes early might mean that something's going to happen that shouldn't. So all my time is measured out. Like, if I want to just do 2 minutes, I'll make sure that I'm putting on my shoe on the last 1.59 seconds.
We're going to move on, because she's taking us off topic. As always, she's taking us off topic. So we're going to keep it moving. Move in. Okay, so now we're at this dreaded segment. So, Marlon. What's not on Marlon's mind?
Well, I started something. Now I got to figure out how to finish it. So I woke up the other I woke up the other morning, and I've been wanting to do this for a while. And I just said, I haven't done anything for myself in a long time. And I looked over and I said, I'm going to put like a little breakfast nook in my bedroom, like set it up, like where I could sit and read and, you know, the sunshine. So I started on this project, and it's not going so well right now. I ordered everything. I ordered the chairs, like my front door. You can't get in my front door because I got the chairs sitting there because I can't take them upstairs yet. The dresser that I did it backwards. Like, the dresser should have been already out on the trash on Wednesday, but it wasn't. So now it's in upstairs in the hallway. I cleaned it out, but now it's in upstairs in the hall. So really, my house is like the death trap. If anybody try to rob me, you're going to die because you're going to hit something. Like, but so I'm figuring out how to put myself out of the situation. I gotta get organized. I'll start. So then I'll start it. And so I turned off television. I thought that was the best thing to do. turn off the TV, it's going to be okay. But then I turned the radio. So I'm dancing. My mom, bless her, she's sitting in the hallway just shaking her head. And she said, so mommy, you want to cheese?
Oh, no.
So I want to get together. Wish I could call somebody who knows how to organize stuff. Let them started it. It would have been much better. That's what, if you know anybody who could come immediately, I mean immediately, to redo my room, I would
well, so Marlon, path for them, because you said anyone that comes in is gonna.
What did you say?
I asked if you were gonna make a clear path for that person, because you said if someone comes into your home, they're gonna die because of all the things sitting around.
Oh, what's the path? Okay, it's only a bigger skinny suit.
What I don't understand, let me tell you what I don't understand. I don't understand how she could be our friend, how Marlon can be our friend. I don't understand how she's in our environment. And she's not organized. Apparently I'm failing, and Marzina, you're failing too, because it's just not rubbing off, and we talk about organization all the time.
Marlon's mom has been crying how many years?
Born to be wild.
You're not failing.
There go Ruben. Uh-huh. Yeah, that's her theme song. That's her theme song.
But you know what? When I get something in my mind, I know it's going to be done. It's just that I have to get motivated. And my motivation is sometimes I'm motivated to do, and like I got a lot of things on my mind right now. And I know this, I have to have this done because it's part of something else that I have to achieve. So once I get started, like really started, like in my mind, it'll get done. But right now, it's just that like I'm like, oh, I gotta do it. Like, oh, I don't have anybody here. Like, oh, why did I start this project? Like, I could, but you know, the best part of the project was that I got to order a bunch of stuff. That was the best part. But then I realized, like, now you gotta do this on your own. So it's making me accomplish a small task, because I'm realizing, like, sometimes I have maybe ADD or whatever it is, because I'll look at something for 5 minutes and be like, oh, this is great. And then I'll be on something else. So I'm trying to focus in on getting rid of stuff. And like the bad thing about it is, as I started removing stuff out of my room, I started finding stuff and reminiscing about who gave it to me, and then moving stuff. Can I really get rid of this? And then the pile just kept on getting bigger and bigger. And so now the stuff that should be out of my room in the trash at the thing is now just sitting in a pile that I'm looking at. Like, I went out and I said, I'm gonna buy these big bins and these big trash cans so that I can get rid of all of this stuff, because I shouldn't be holding on. See, that's what we do. We hold on to stuff and we say, this is a memory. This is that. But those memories are 20 years old. If I remember it, let's get rid of it, you know? But I think that's what's holding me back, because like I even found a picture that my godson gave me, and he has passed away. So I'm holding on to the picture and I'm laughing about what me and him used to do. Then I started dancing again, running around. And then I'm sitting there and I said, oh, let me fold these clothes while I'm sitting here. So I got a half a bin of clothes unfolded, a half a bin of clothes. And then I'm like, okay, I'm tired of folding clothes. Let me vacuum the little part that I cleaned out. So I started, and I just can't get focused on doing the one thing. Like, you know, it's like, it's crazy. So right now, Marlon, I promised my mom, it will be done tonight.
Marlon, you're going to actually get some tips today that you can use as well.
Yes.
Thank God spring's coming, because that's probably when she'll get it done, because spring's coming. But here's one thing that keeps us from our goals, and that is asking for help.
Yes.
You have a brother who lives very close to you.
Well,
so
girl,
he
came over yesterday and said, "Morning, we're going to get these chairs and stuff upstairs. We're going to get this done." I said, "Oh, don't worry. I brought some bins. I'm halfway."
Your own issue. See, you don't have to work together.
Now I got to go to work tomorrow, but I'm telling him, "Don't worry about it. I'm going to get this done tomorrow." So he came yesterday when he was supposed to come, because I told him that's when I wanted to take this up. So it's not my brother. My nephews were ready. My nephews was like, "Aunt Marmar, we're going to take this stuff out for you." I was like, "Oh, don't worry about it just yet. I'm almost still working on it." And so I put everything in a nice pile to make it me feel comfortable going to sleep last night. I should have left it the way it is now, because I would have worked all night and got it done. But I can't, well, one thing I can't do is like sleep in a bunch of, well, I don't have nowhere on my bed to sleep because all the junk is on there. So
okay. All right. We're going to move on.
Okay.
Now we're finding out more and more about Marmar. She, you know, we're going to have to create a show just for her. And then once we do that,
let's talk about it.
Okay, but this is something that I definitely want to talk about. I know we've talked about it we've a little bit, and then somebody would always take us off course whenever we're speaking. But I wanted to bring up the reinventing ourselves again, only because, you know, it's closer to my heart now than ever before. And we have to do this in order to move forward. And a lot of people don't have the resources to even start it. So Marzina and I were two, you know, certified professional coach, and we can help people reinvent our, you know, their lives. You know, so first let's talk about what does it mean to reinvent your life? Reinventing. And it means to Go ahead, Marlon.
As you say that, I'm joking, but what I did is I started getting to a point where I became complacent, and I started saying, "This is going to be my life, and this is the life that I'm just going to end up living." And the other day, a few weeks ago, it's terrible, but it happened when I fell down the steps and now see my life flashed before my eyes. So when I started realizing, like, wait, have I truly lived out everything that I wanted to do? Have I started accomplishing things that I want to do? I want to be more successful. I want to be a better leader. I want to be able to speak and help people more. I want to be more in tune with my purpose in life. So I started reading these books. Like you, Z, I love to read. I love reading, and I love things that not only enhance my knowledge, but give me, you know, some encouragement, some motivation to go on. So I started reading these books and I started doing different things. And as I started reading the books, I started saying, wait, Marlon, you left this old person behind you for a reason. You have to put yourself in a better place now. So now, like when I say when I woke up and I looked at my room and said something needed to be done, that's me starting to create and make new memories for myself, create new places in my life, you know, just create a better place. Like I'm doing it slow. I laugh, I joke. I mean, it'll get done, but these are little steps that I'm taking. Like it's something big that I want to do. I'm probably going to announce sooner, once I finish like accomplishing this short little goal I have for myself, I'm going to announce it and let everybody know. But at this time, I'm putting in place where I'm creating more so that I can do more. I'm starting to realize what my purpose is, and realizing what my purpose is in life, I know there's changes. Like I'm looking around my house and I'm like, I've been here 16 years. And I'm looking at stuff and never thought it needed to be changed. And now I'm sitting here and I'm like, wait, I need this. I got to change this. I got to do this. I got to do that. I got to let go of some of these old things that are holding me back so that I can get new things. And, you know, and I swear, like, I mean, it's just like even letting go of some people. Like, it, on my way, I know it sounds bad, but reinventing yourself means you got to put yourself around different people as well. You know, thank God I have you and Gail and Marzina, because y'all help me. Y'all be like, listen, no, stop, don't do it. Like, I take y'all information. I joke and tease with, but that's just me. Y'all know I love to laugh, but I take what the information y'all give me to help me to move on. So I'm just learning. I'm putting myself around different people as well, and letting go some unhealthy relationships. And I mean, not that I'm completely, but I know that I can't be around these relationships all the time because it's bringing me down. It's not helping me get to where I want to go.
And that's okay. Yeah. And then that's okay, because we can still love them, because God tells us that we are supposed to love, period. But you're just loving them from a distance for now. So, but you're starting. Yeah. You started with step one. Yeah. Step one, see yourself outside of yourself and find your starting point. You know, right now, you done looked around your house, you done been there for 16 years, and you know you need to change, okay? So you, and that's the first thing, you know you need to change. There's things that you don't want in your life and you want to change it, you want to move on. You want to move towards your purpose. That's a different show. I got a challenge for that. But yeah, that's step one. Identifying, okay, this just isn't working for me anymore. I want more. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, I want more. And then next you have to identify what's important to you. What truly matters to you? Is it family, freedom, financial freedom, freedom not having to work somebody else's job? Freedom in relationships, letting some things go, or strengthening relationships with family, significant other, you know, whatever.
Guys,
yes.
One of the first steps I think everyone should make when trying to make this reinventing yourself thing work, you have to kind of project yourself into your future.
Yep.
Right? You have mm-hmm. to ask yourself, what will I regret not having done in my life?
Oh, yeah.
Then the process begins. Then you start working backwards to make sure that that ending does not come to that. So
and
to me,
hopefully
that's
you know. Things. Hopefully you know. But if you don't know, it's like, okay, where do you start? And one of the things that I like, I really do like showing that the clip from Titanic, the ending. When I'm teaching adults, and I show that so that they can identify or help them identify how they want their life to be. You know, what do you want? As I always say on the show, it's like, I don't want to get older and have all the faculties of my mind and the limitations of my body and have to shoulda, woulda, coulda. But if you don't know, when you don't know what you want to do, this is the, you know, the process. It's like, okay, first you have to see yourself. Who are you? What do you stand for? What's important to you? And then we need to, you know, look at your core value. Is family important? What if you don't have family? Okay, well, what about friends? What about your environment, your community? What's important? And that's another way to find out what your passion is. And here's what Marlon's doing. She, you know, here's one step, clearing space for reinvention.
Yes.
That's the reason why she's making that path in that her bedroom, making that space so that she'll have more room to do the things that she wants to do in her life. And one of the things are reading and the other one's a secret because she's not telling. But she's creating that space in her life. Just like she said, she's getting rid of people in her life, those relationships that's not going anywhere. She's at that place right now where she's making space. So this is going to be interesting what she comes up with. Go ahead, Marzina.
Guys, one of the most important things of making change is decluttering your life. which Marlon is doing through people, things, you know, having clutter around you and all these different things that just throws you off your game each and every day. So that is one of the first steps as well. Decluttering.
And you know what? And Gail has talked about decluttering, and she has told me this for a long time. Y'all don't think she hasn't told me to declutter. But you know how in life you hear things, and they don't mean anything to you maybe at that point in time when you're hearing it, but you store it somewhere in your brain. And when you need it, it starts to come out. Now, what in my life, I started looking at the people who are around me. I started looking at the things that are around me. And I started saying, look, I love positivity. I love people who speak positive, who do this, who do that. I love people who are building, have the same, you know, mindset as me. Like, don't have the same crazy mind as me. I'm just saying, I want people who are growing and loving to do stuff like me. I love stuff for the community. I love being able to give back to my community. I love being able to help the youth maybe succeed and stuff. So I'm looking to see, like, who is helping me get to where I want to go? Who is on the same path that I am, and who is actually going to help me? Like, I love people like entrepreneurs because they have something in them that led them to do it. That success that he had in them, leadership they have in them. No, like we say, you can fall a million times, but you all have a chance to get up. So as I grow, I mean, it's not that I have fallen many a times. Like I fall like all the time. And but I get up, I laugh, but I know that I have to make a change. And when I fall, and like y'all don't realize that fall really did traumatize me. When I was laying on that step and I seen everything done, I said, Marlon, something's not right. And I was just, you know, my anxiety was heightened and everything, and I'm not thinking normal. You know, just started stepping away from certain things, started saying, Marlon, this is what caused this, this is what caused that. And then I went to reading my books, and I read these books, and it's like how to speak differently, how to think differently, how you should act, you know, how leadership, how to manage this, how to do this. And this author, I mean, she writes a lot of books. Y'all, you two being life coaches, y'all probably heard of her as well. Her name is Valerie Burton. Like, I read a lot of her books, and they're pretty good, you know. But I also look at stuff, and I read little inspirational quotes that people put on their things, because sometimes a little word, like two sentences or two words, may help you. So that's what right now in my life, like, I'm decluttering, I'm moving out the old, but I'm trying to also build new relationships that'll get me to where I want to go to. I want to be in new positive relationships. I don't want relationships that drain me. I don't want to put too much work into it. I want to just be an authentic, humble, you know, authentic relationship.
So Marlon, that fall jarred something in you.
Absolutely. I thought I was going to die. I said, Lord Jesus, I literally thought I was going to die. I was all twisted up on the steps, and I thought I was going to die. Yeah, so.
But look at what's happening as a result.
Yeah.
Do I need to fall down? No, I'm just playing.
No, the fall. Listen, because I still got it. No. I still got it.
but you know what? But what it, you know, that fall may have been a blessing in disguise for her to start taking care more seriously, you know. And I am real big on watching your environment that you're in. I remember I was at a leadership conference in Seattle, Washington. Oh, it's been over 15 years. And I remember Dr. Bridget Hilliard, she once said, and this is the only thing I remember from the conference, she said, and I quote, "Your environment will change you before you change it." Mm-hmm. Okay. So we might as well go after the environment that we want. We want to be around or in an environment where people have a like mind as you do. Okay, you want to build something, you go into a website, you find that environment that's going to help you establish your purpose and your goals. You know, and right now I know it's limited to like online social services, you know, Facebook, but there are a lot of coaches who are doing even more outside of Facebook. But, you know, teaching, I know I'm coming, I've created a class in regards to life fulfillment. So that's going to be coming out very soon. Marzina, she's working with, you know, a group of women. So you got to check out her Facebook group. So she's going to talk about that later on. But we have to put ourselves in the environment where we want to go. We want to be able to learn from somebody who knows more than you do. That's yes. How I feel. I do not want to be the smartest person in the room, because if I'm the smartest person in the room, I'm going to be bored.
Yeah,
right. I'm going to be bored. Go ahead.
Exactly. And one important part in this whole process is you have to pull yourself away from your comfort zones.
Mm-hmm.
That's important. Your old habits, your self-perceptions of yourself, because in most cases, a lot of us are just learning that our self-perception is not on point. So a lot of people are changing now. Some people are there, but we got to just push everything away that we're used to.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it doesn't feel good. It's a little scary, but guess what? It's got to be done.
And you know, it is scary. Coming out of that comfort zone is very scary, because we're talking about dealing with the unknown. And when we deal with the unknown, we get fearful. It's like, oh, I don't know how it's going to turn out. But we got to step out on faith. We got to step out. Because here's the thing. Nothing will change unless we make a change. We got to make the change in order for us to have the lifestyle we want, in order the business we want, in order to just grow. We have to make that change and step out. You know, yeah. We got to talk of, you know, those goals that we set for ourselves. They got to be smart. They got to be smart. And it is called smart goals. But, you know, it needs to be specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time bound. You know, we have to set those goals. You know, if we stay stagnant, you know, like you said, I'm like, we're just going to be stuck. Can you just imagine having the light, having the potential, but having the life to not do anything?
I don't know about you guys, but I did that for a long time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I did the same thing, Z. Once, you know, I got comfortable with my job, but I wasn't going anywhere in my job. And I finally did speak up for myself. And, you know, I did, you know, but I was so just, I got a job. I make enough money to support my household income. I'm doing good. I drive, my bills is paid. I'm not getting a new car because I'm just comfortable, you know? And these things just started making me say, Marlon, you're getting comfortable in a lifestyle that you weren't, that's not what you really wanted to do in life. What I wanted to do, I wanted to do so much, but then I started saying, I'm getting older. You know, you got to start thinking like, I got to be more grounded. I have to be able to retire. I mean, I've set my life up where I can retire. I mean, I have no children. I'm not married. I have no responsibilities to anyone but myself. Well, I take care of my mom and I love her to death. But like my mom has always told me, you got to live your life. If anything happens to me, you got to be able to continue to go on and live your life. And she said, I want you to live a happy life, not a life that somebody else told you. Like even now, I had to come over the fear of leaving my mom alone. Like, and I used to be like, can I leave her alone for 30? I can leave my mama alone for, she puts me out of room. She tells me to get out, you know, these are things like, but in my mind, I was so scared because it just takes me back. Like, did I do something wrong if I leave her? If this happened, you know, this is gonna, no, she's fine. But I had to come over things that I just planted in my mind and they weren't real. You know what I'm saying? Like these are falsities that I'm like, oh, if I leave my mom alone for 20 minutes, she's gonna, just something's gonna happen. No, she's perfectly fine. We sit in the house all the time. I'm downstairs watching an hour long show. I don't know what she's doing upstairs, but I fear like if I'm, you know, leaving her, but I had to get over these certain fears. So now I'm starting to realize like, Marnie, you have to live for yourself. And I got a birthday mm-hmm. coming up. Well, y'all know I celebrate my birthday all year. It's not like it's anything new.
Oh, so, yes.
I got my birthday coming up and I'm going to live and I'm going to continue to live, but I'm making these changes and I'll probably announce it around my birthday. Y'all going to be like, what? But yeah, so it's something exciting. But right now I'm doing the groundwork on it. So hopefully it works out. But I'm just trying to be more happy.
Not hope, it will work.
Yeah.
As long as you keep making those progression each and every day, you're doing something to reach your goals. See, and that's another thing. We can't just put it out in the air and say, oh, this is how I want my life to be and not set the goals and not do something to obtain it each and every day.
Mm-hmm. What's that Bible saying? Faith without works is dead or something like that?
Faith without works is dead. You'll have the faith, but if you don't work it, then it's dead. It's not going to come into fruition. If you have goals, but yet you don't do the work behind it to reach it, it's going to die. We talked about dead dreams before. We got to bring that one back. But we have to do something constantly in order to reach the goal, even if it's learning about it. Say you're not doing an active thing as setting something up or whatever, but what if you're reading about it? That's doing something. We have to continuously learn. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't like all that learning stuff when it comes to things like Facebook. I'm like, Dret, you know how much I'm not a fan of Facebook, but I know that that's one of the ways socially to get through to some people who will definitely need my help.
Especially in this
So I'm like, okay, it's finally clicking in that I really need to have more of a presence. And so that's what I'm going to be doing, like some of these pop-ups. You know, I can't wait to get started.
Well, you've been doing pretty good lately. You've been doing pretty good. I've been seeing you on there. Now I try to go on there and I see where you post stuff too, which is very inspirational. Me, I'll post a bunch of junk, but it's okay. I'm not a life coach. I'm just a comedian behind the two life coaches.
Hey, it needs comedians too, Marlon.
Yes.
I want to touch on what something Gail just said a minute ago, putting in the time to actually do things. What helped me transition is having or setting aside 1 hour a day, just one. Feeding, doing what will help me. That could be reading, it could be research, it could be whatever. Just dedicate 1 hour a day to what you want to obtain. That's it.
Yeah.
At least an hour. And what is that, an hour? You know, that's what I tell myself to get myself to the gym. You know, you're worth an hour at the gym. You're worth it.
So you have the rest of the day. I'm still talking to myself about it, but yeah.
Yeah, and that's what gets me. I'm like, I'm worth an hour. Yeah. Your goals, if it's important to you, it's worth at least an hour. Okay? That's it. We got to put the time in order to get it out. So let's look at what happens if you don't. You won't thrive. You won't meet your goals. You have these doubts. Well, you know, I wanted to do this, but I can't put the time in, or I got kids, or I got to work. I'm like, Marzine, how long did we go to school? And how many hours was that after work?
You can just have 101 excuses of why you can't do something. And, you know, but why don't you give yourself that one excuse that makes you do something? Like, you know, like Well, I went and had the COVID vaccine. I went and got the COVID vaccine. But I got myself so worked up over this COVID vaccine. Let me tell you, I could have died. Like, that's what I was like, oh, let me go. My mom got, you know what? I embarrassed my mom so much. It's terrible. So we're in there. And so the people are looking to take it. Now they should be more paying attention to my mom. And they're paying attention to me. I was like, mom, do I look pale? And the lady started looking. I was like, oh, my mom. My mom had to hold my hand. And I'm terrified of needles anyway. So my mom is holding my hand. And then I felt the squeeze where she was like, you better cut it out. You know that, like when you was a kid and your mom gave you that extra, y'all know what it is, because y'all got kids, that extra little squeeze or that little pinch. So I was in there, and I told the lady I couldn't see the needle. Like, don't let me see the needle. I'm going to probably get sick or whatever, right? She forgets that. So now I'm like, oh, and she's like, are you okay? And my mom is holding my hand. She holding my hand. So I'm like this. So she squeezed my hand. And when she squeezed my hand, everything was all right. The lady, I didn't feel the needle go in. I didn't even know she was finished. She had put the Band-Aid on. And I'm looking at my mom. Like, and I'm like, okay, you can do it now. She said, honey, I'm done. I said, oh. And then, so then you got to go to the observation spot, right? You go to observation for 15 minutes. Now, me being the paranoid person that I am about COVID, I had a regular surgical mask on my mom. Then I had we have Vera Bradley masks, and I put the other surgical. So we basically had three masks over our face, right? Because it was too many people in the area. So the guy comes around saying, can y'all breathe? And me and my, and I didn't want to say, like, because they want to know if you have any problems. And my mom is looking at me. Now, you can't see her eyes because I made sure she had goggles on, like, in her shades, you know. And then so she's like this. My mom is looking at me like, no, I can't breathe because this fool done got me with three masks on. And I'm sitting there and I'm saying, well, is it because we have so many masks on that we can't breathe, or we have an allergic reaction? And my mom is looking at me just shaking her head. But let me tell you, it's not what it is. The COVID, if you have a chance to get it, to help your community, to get back to being normal, it's okay. If I can do it, anybody can do it. But I did have my mom hold my hand. I know how old I am, and don't laugh. But my mommy had to hold my hand. My mommy held my hand, and we got through it. And when we got out, we ripped the mask off. I was like, I could breathe again. But I knew we were going to be safe, so that was it. You know, I didn't have any side effects or anything, but yeah.
Wait a minute. I'm trying to figure out. Now, it's good that you went and got the shot. I got the vaccine, too. It really... Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out where and how did we get on that topic, even though it's funny, you know.
I was just pops into my mind. Oh, about fear. What fear can do. What fear can do to you.
Okay.
To your mind, create things that so I had fear. And I had to overcome this fear, but I got to the end goal. I got to my end goal of getting the vaccine, and then realizing that I'm going to be alive. Like, I'm still alive. I'm still here. I can still talk about this, even though I was scared out my mind. My mom, how not to embarrass my mom on every little time.
Okay, well, so we're going to get back into reinventing. Yes, you know, after, you know, we do all this, you know, building that foundation, identifying who you are and what you want, and decluttering, you know, our lives, you know, and once we identify what our goals are, we have to stay focused because there's a lot of things that can take you off course. So we have to stay on course. Life gets in the way, but we need to identify some of the barriers that can get in our way. Okay. Mm-hmm. One barrier could be children. You know, if you have children, but yet you aspire to do more, they can be a barrier, but it's not like you can't conquer your goals and still have children. Sometimes they may be an excuse. So one of the things that can happen is that, okay, well, maybe you might have to get up earlier or go to bed a little bit later so that you can take care of some things, creating that time to do it. Yes, Marzina.
Yeah, and that should be one of the areas that you focus on when you're doing the plan. What barriers you might happen, what you're going to do to overcome them. So that's all part of the planning. Of course, you can't account for everything that may happen, but it helps to have these backup things in your head when these things occur. So
exactly. That's just like, you know, when I was, you know, in school, my thing was, okay, you know, I have this, you know, son, and I had to, you know, take care of him. Like, who's going to take care of him? And just anybody can't do it. So luckily I had the support system that I had that allowed me to, you know, go to school and feel comfortable with leaving him with my mother or my brother or one of my close friends. So there was only like three people, but you know, that's a barrier, you know, so work could be a barrier. Maybe you can, you know, change your work hours. So you have to identify those barriers ahead of time and try and make some kind of provision so that those barriers won't become a permanent obstacle. Yes, Mark.
And you know, a lot of people say it's time and finances and things like that. But if you reorganize your schedule, that corrects that barrier of time. And what a lot of people don't know, sometimes if you just relook at your finances and reconfigure what you're going to put your money into, most of the time you can do anything you want to. It's what you want to put. So a lot of people always say, I don't have enough money, you know, or I don't have the time. But you really do, because if you, like, a lot of things, like I always say, oh, I don't have the money for that. But the reason I don't have the money, because I don't want to make time, want to make enough money to do what I want to do. That gives me an excuse to back away. Where something as simple as, okay, Marnie, you're not buying a pair of shoes this week, and you're not doing this, you're not going to eat out, and boom, at the end of the week, you have the money to accomplish that goal. But in my mind, I'm saying, no, my money is tied up. But like, that is one big barrier that everybody, well, two, that people put up there and say, I can't do it because I don't have the time and I don't have the money. Once you overcome those two, I believe you can move forward in a lot of things you want to do as well.
But that makes a good point, because and then you have, sometimes you have people who just don't want to pay for it. They just don't want to pay for it. And sometimes you have to pay the cost to reach your goals, and it may be costly with your money and or your time, but either way there's going to be a cost. Everything is not a freebie.
Nope.
It really isn't. Everything's not a freebie. Okay, right now, okay, it may be free to go get your associates, but it's not going to be free to get your bachelor's or your master's or your doctorate's.
Oh yeah, I know that. Oh,
huh?
Yeah. Boy, do I know that. Oh,
yeah.
Oh.
The thing is, if it's something that you really want, you're going to have to pay the cost. Mm-hmm. And if you don't want to pay the cost for what you want, what is that saying about you? What kind of life is that going to lead you to? Go ahead, Marzina.
It's not many things that are free. Okay, I can only think of a few things in life that were free and really beneficial for me. Mm-hmm. Think of it like that. It's a cost to everything. And aren't you worth it?
How much of a sacrifice are you willing to make so that you can achieve what you hope to achieve? Like, you got to be willing to give up something and get something, you know? And whether it be your time, whether it be money, whether it just be giving up doing certain things in life, you know, sometimes, you know, giving up little things can help you achieve bigger things. And so you got to know what you're willing to sacrifice and how much you're willing to sacrifice so that you can achieve what you need to achieve. Because the end goal is what probably way bigger than where you are today. Like, you can't be, if you're looking to achieve something and where you are today isn't where you want to be tomorrow, you got to start making sacrifices. You got to say, maybe it might be stepping away from your, you might love your family to death, love them to death, but all your time is going to your family. You might have to start saying, listen, this day, don't bother me. I'm focused on this. Like, step away from your family. It's not neglecting them or anything. It's just saying, I need this time for myself so that I can build on what I need to build on. And you can't, and then you might say, listen, for a month or two, we can't eat out. I have to do this. So understand that we're going to eat at home for a month or two. Be prepared. I'm going to the grocery store. Well, I haven't said that to myself yet, but I'm going to try. But I'm just saying, like, you got to be knowing what you're willing to do, how you're going to do it, and the sacrifices that you're willing to make so that you can continue to advance and grow on what, and to meet your goal. Like, you know, you set goals for yourself, but if you're not willing to put in the work, if you're not willing to make the sacrifices for something, I remember when I entered into my first master's program, they said, you will not be able to spend, it was on a weekend. I had classes on the weekend. And the teacher was very serious. He said, you might as well tell your family now that you won't be spending, you know, time, or if you have this and this. And he said, prepare yourself. He said, because if you don't dedicate yourself to this program, you're going to fail. And at first class, I said, whatever, I do what I want. I'm smart enough. When I tell you, I could barely hold my eyes open because I had so much work that I thought I could do, because during the week, I felt I could do everything I wanted to. I'd be sitting there nodding my head, trying to type a paper or whatever. And then finally, I realized, like, Marlon, if you would have dedicated 3 to 4 hours, you know, every day to this thing and wrote, the paper would have probably been awesome. But you're sitting there one night trying to write a paper. Yes, I did get a good grade. Could I have gotten a better grade? Could I put in more information? Probably so. But I didn't listen to when somebody advised me of what I would need to do to accomplish it. But as it went on, the years went on, I knew that I had to set time aside so that I can accomplish that goal. And then even when I entered the doctor's program, they said, you might as well tell your family you're going to be busy for 2 years. Let it go, you know. And then, and I was like, 2 years? It's me with that same mind frame. I did this, I did that. Realized they were telling me the truth, you know. So it's certain things that you got to listen to, take the information that is given and use it to your advantage. But you also got to be willing to make the sacrifice and to do what you need to do and give up some stuff, you know, to achieve the goal.
And that's anyway. True. You know, you had to come up with a habit. See, you did not come up with that habit when studying and doing the papers, because the habit will develop a system. And the system is something that you do every day. That's part of the thing. You need that system in order to meet your goal. Habit creates system, creates you reaching your goal. And that's what a lot of people do miss. But here's the thing. Once we reach our goals and you look back, it's like, dang, I done did it. You evaluate along the lines, but once you reach your goal, it's like, I did it. I can accomplish anything that I want because I did that. I conquered it. I achieved it. And it makes you feel good when you achieve a goal. It's your goal. You have to make sure that is your goal, not someone else's goal. Because if it's somebody else's goal, it's not going to be important to you. So reinvention is an art. It really is. You have to plan for it. You have to create it. Well, you have to create it first, plan for it, and work your plan. You know, it's not a quick fix. It's not an easy thing to do. We can tell you, it's hard to reinvent yourself. But if it's something that you want to do, you will do it. If it's something worth to you has some worth and has some value for you to accomplish, the time is going to be worth it. So there's no quick fix. There's no overnight solutions. So we just have to, you know, put our running shoes on and get to stepping. Hey, I like that. Put your running shoes on.
And you know what, Gail? Another thing is you're never too old to change. You're never too old. No matter what you go through, if you feel in your life that you need to make that change, change. You know, it. You know, if you see yourself stuck somewhere, and I don't care if you're 50 years, listen, you can always learn something new. You can always be able to change something that you have done. If you have a bad habit, you can get rid of it. That's why people can stop smoking. They can stop doing drugs. They can stop doing this. They can stop doing, because they're working on making change and they're sticking to making that change. So in your life, never feel because I'm this age, I'm too old to change. You know, it's a lot of things in my life I had to learn how to redo. You know, I was the one when I was literally 39, I had to learn how to be more responsible. Now, all my life, I ran free. My mom let me run free through this world and wreak havoc on everybody. And then at 39, I had to realize and wake up and become responsible, taking care of the finances in my home, taking care of me and my mom, making sure everything was done when I never had that responsibility in my life. But I had the information and the knowledge to do it because my mom placed it in me. I just never had to use it. So I had to reinvent myself to say, no, you know, I had to start saying, now you got to be this responsible person. Now you got to look to your future, even though my future, look, if you don't do this, like, I never really cared too much. I'd be like, I'll do this, I'll do that. But I had to learn to make changes in order so that my future would look the way that I wanted it to look. I don't want to be sitting there at 75 at my desk talking about, man, I wish I would have invested some money so I didn't have to work all my life. Mm-hmm. Or, man, I wish I didn't go buy a house right before I retire. And now I got to try to think about paying a mortgage. You know what I'm saying? Like, when I retire out, I'm not going to have no car payment, no mortgage. I'm going to just be running this world wild. If y'all rock, but I'm just saying, you're never too old to change. Like, don't let somebody tell you, like, where you are, you're going to stay there. You always can be better than what you are today. That's how I feel. Wherever you are today, definitely, you can always be better.
Yes. Definitely. So, and you know what? And I agree so much with Marlon. Age is nothing but a number. If you have something in your heart to do, then do it. Do it. So before we close, I want Marzina to talk about her Facebook group.
Yeah. Well, I'm still in the developing stages. I have a Facebook group just basically motivating women to be their best selves. I'm making some changes, going to start adding videos. I'm actually going to be starting a podcast soon. Awesome. So I'm working on that as well. So I'm going to be putting questions out there as far as what people want to see. Mm-hmm. So I'm still creating. The group is there, but yeah, it's a good group of women. I love these ladies. Let me just tell you, you need that special group. And to me, us ladies have to have each other's back, period. We know how sometimes things are shady at the workplace and shady, you know, the men getting more privileges, getting paid more. No. We have to lift each other up by each arm, our sisterhood, and do
the. What is the name of your Facebook page?
Fierce Women, Powerful Purpose.
And Gail, what is the name of your Facebook page?
Positive Influence.
And let me tell y'all something. I follow both of them. And when these ladies tell you they're giving you information that's going to help you, it helps you. In the morning, when you wake up and you see that inspirational quote, you might be feeling some type of way. It encourages you to actually get up and do what you have to do. So ladies, continue to do what you do. I'm not doing that. I'm not a life coach.
Listen, I love what we've done today. But just so everyone knows, make your plan. Make it. Accept each and every one of your flaws. And then make the corrections that are needed. And never stop learning. This is what
life
is. Ongoing learning is the best thing in the world. I don't care if it's personal stuff, business stuff. You cannot stop learning because the world is changing so quickly around us every day. So we got to keep up.
And you know what? When you talk about learning, you can learn something from even a child sometimes. Just be willing to accept the knowledge that is given to you. Accept what people are offering you. And don't be closed-minded. Be open-minded to new things and to learn new things, because that also helps you to grow. As you learn more, you grow more. You start eliminating some of the ignorance that you have. Like me, y'all know I'm ignorant to the, like, my ignorance is on 1,000. Like, but I try to correct it. I try to be better. You know, I try. But, you know, as long as you keep an open mind and allow people to talk and you listen and and some of your opinions might end up being eliminated about certain things, you know, some things, but, you know, keep an open mind. And yeah, like you said, Z, you can learn something from everybody and continue to learn. You know, it's not all about being books and degrees and everything, because you can learn something from a bum on the street. So
that's true.
Okay, so that's another addition to Sister Talk. So thank you for listening. Please go to our Facebook page. Leave a comment. If you want to be a part of Positive Influence or Marzina's Facebook group, Fierce for Women. You know, just drop us a line. So thank you for listening, and we'll see you in 2 weeks.
Yes.
Thank you. Have a blessed day.
Bye-bye. Bye, everybody.